Good morning mga kababayan. Kumusta kayo dyan? Dito po ay good morning. Baka mamaya makadinig kayo ng tilaok ng manok. Ito po ang inyong Visa Bulletin Report for Friday. Okay. Ito po ang inyong kabisang Cris Aranda para sa Immigrant Visa Center para sa ating Visa Bulletin Report. Ngayong October 16. Okay. 16, alas 2 ng hapon, wala pa rin ang visa bulletin ng State Department. So, ang ating pag-uusapan pa rin ang public charge at sino maapektuhan. How many Filipinos would be affected by the changes in the public charge rule, the current final rule and the proposed public rule? So, sino ang maapektuhan? Who will be affected? Will you be one of those who will be affected? Kung kayo maapektuhan, anong inyong magiging reaksyon? Ang inyong magiging reaksyon, kung kayo maapektuhan, tingnan natin. Palagay ko, ganito magiging itsura nyo. Ayan, ang magiging itsura nyo. Okay, kung kayo maapektuhan, nako, paano ba yan? Maapektuhan niya ata ako. Teka, patigilin muna natin itong ating Visa Bulletin Report. Okay. Okay, yan po. Yan ang ating itsura. Kung ay maapektuhan. Kawawa naman kung maapektuhan. Okay, how many Filipino immigrant visa applicants would be affected by the current and proposed rule on public charge and affidavit of support? Okay, the U.S. Supreme Court has allowed the Department of State and the Department of Homeland Security, DOS and DHS, to implement the final rule. Ito yung rule that was the subject of several court proceedings sa district court. But the Supreme Court issued a rule that the Department of State and Department of Homeland Security can now implement the final rule. In addition, there is a proposed rule and we shall be discussing that. All right. Okay. The comments, ito po, meron kayong magagawa dun sa comments because the period to submit comments, whether you are for or against the proposed rule, and we shall discuss that later, the comments would be still be available and open to the public until the 2nd of November 2020. So you have about more than 2 weeks to submit your comments, and later on we shall give you the link on how you can submit your comments dito para alam nyo kung anong inyong pwede magawa, what you can do. Okay, anong inyong pwedeng magawa kung sakali. Tingnan po natin. Alright. So, next. Ilan ang maapektuhan dito sa ating ilan ang maapektuhan? Overall, all over the world, it's ito yung mga Filipino applicants po ito ha. Filipino immigrant visa applicants na maapektuhan, 291,392. These are Filipino immigrants who are waiting for their visas, whether they are in the U.S. or they are here in the Philippines. Now, before the ban, before the immigrant visa ban that was issued by President Trump, nung February and then nung June, the average number of visas issued at the U.S. Embassy in Manila before the immigrant visa ban was 1,654. Ito po yan. Ayan, oh. Follow the arrow. Ayan. Ayan. Follow the arrow. Ayan. Gumagalaw na arrow. 1,654 ang available na visas or binibigay na visas on the average every month sa mga Pilipino dito sa U.S. Embassy sa Manila. After the ban, starting March of 2020, ang average visa na binibigay sa mga Pilipino is 587. And the ban on admission of immigrants would be valid until December 31st, 2020. The ban may be extended, expanded, depending on the outcome of the U.S. elections in November of 2020. At alam naman niyo siguro yan. If President Trump becomes reelected or he gets reelected, eh, sasabihin niya, it's the mandate of the American people that I should proceed and continue with my immigrant restrictions. So, good morning sa iyo, Manok. So, lalong hihigpit ito, yung immigrant visa admission. Kaya, tingnan po natin what happens after that. But, kung nakikita nyo itong mga nakapila sa US Embassy, yan po ay, pagpalagay natin, these are part of the 291,000 Filipino immigrants waiting for their visas all over the world. Eto, ano naman ang breakdown nung mga naghihintay na yan? So, at the bottom here, you can see, there's 291,392 Filipinos, di ba, naghihintay ng kanilang visa overall, all over the world. Now, ilan dito ang naghihintay sa F1 category? Ano yung F1 category? These are the over 21 unmarried sons and daughters of U.S. citizens ang nakapila. And that was November 2019. So, after 1 year, nadagdagan pa ito because the USCIS gets the approved petition. Yung mga petition na ipinafile, they get them tens of thousands every day. So, nadagdagan pa ito. Ito po ay yun lamang waiting list sa State Department as of November 2019. So, ang naghihintay sa F1, over 21 unmarried sons and daughters of U.S. citizens ito, hindi ito LPRs. Ito po ay U.S. citizen. So, palitan natin. Of U.S. citizens. Ayan. Palitan natin siya para malinaw. U.S. citizens. Ayan. Okay, U.S. citizens. So, gawin natin capital ang U.S. U.S. citizens. Live po tayong nagbibigay ng update sa inyo eh. Kaya pati yung mga aso natin live din. Kung anong nangyayari sa labas, ibinabalita sa akin. Oh, mukhang may dumarating. Baka immigration ito o State Department. Oy, Aranda, ano yung ginagawa mo dyan? Okay. Good morning sa inyo, mga aso natin dyan at mga manok. Okay. Ulitin natin, F1. Over 21 unmarried sons and daughters of U.S. citizens. 15,283. F2A, ito yung spouse and minor children of green card holders. Ito po ay 5,686. Yan, mas kukonti compared sa F1. F2B itong isa, itong over 21. Over 21 and married sons and daughters of green card holders of LPRs. Ngayon lang po natin ginawa ito eh, kaya pagpasensyahan po ninyo. LPRs. Over 21, ito'y F2B. Ito'y F2B. Kahapon, or nung Wednesday, we were outside and we were looking at how the traffic in the Philippines has increased because of the opening of the economy. And so today, para mas malinaw ang inyong nababasa dito, kasi when I'm outside doing the report live, medyo magalaw po yung ating report. So I decided that today, Friday, 16th of October, gagawin natin ito dito sa ating home base. So ulitin natin. The Filipino immigrant visa applicants in the family-sponsored categories as of November 2019, according to the State Department. Ulitin natin. Yung F1, over 21, unmarried sons and daughters of U.S. citizens, 15,283. F2A, the spouse or minor children of green card holders, 5,686. F2B, ito yung over 21, unmarried sons and daughters of lawful permanent residents or green card holders, 41,892. Doon naman sa mga married sons and daughters of U.S. citizens, F3, 112,514. Sila ang pinakamarami. Ang susunod na pinakamarami, yung F4 or adult brothers and sisters of U.S. citizens. Ang F4 ang naghihintay ng mga Pilipino, 102,721. So overall, lahat-lahat na ito ang naghihintay ng visa as of November 2019 would be 291,392. Ito yung maapektuhan ng rule. Ibig sabihing maapektuhan, sila yung they will be subject to the Affidavit of Support and Public Charge Rule. Yung final rule and the proposed rule if the proposed rule becomes finalized. Okay ba? Okay. The final rule is the current rule. The proposed rule, when it becomes final, hanggang November, 2nd of November ang comments. So malamang yan, by next year, finalized na rin siya. So by next year, kung sa next year pa lang kayo mai-interview, you will be subject to the current rule and to the final rule na na-propose na naging finalized na. Okay. Malinaw ba o kasing labo ng tubig sa putikan? Okay. Yung proposed rule, pag naging final, mapa-finalize siya. If it becomes finalized by January, then you will be subject to it. Ayan po. Alright. Paano naman yung mga spouse and minor children, ng including parents of U.S. citizens? They are not subject to the annual quota. So, hindi sila kasama dito sa waiting list. Ha? Walang naghihintay sa kanila. Dun sa State Department Visa Bulletin. But, remember, even though they are not part of the preference categories, even though they're not part of the visa waiting list, kasama sila naghihintay because they're being processed sa NVC because parang mauna sila dahil sila hindi kasama sa quota, as long as meron silang immigrant visa available na kompleto nila yung processing sa NVC, then mauna sila na mabibigyan ng visa. And they are competing for the visas dun sa 226,000 available. Pag ito ay naging 226,000 na lang, then they will not be competing with you anymore. But they are not competing with you for the state, for the per country allocation. Pag meron silang visa na approved, tuloy-tuloy lang yung kanilang visa processing. Okay? Alright. So, yan po yung mga naghihintay ng mga Pilipino. Next would be... Ito yung issuance ng mga visa and we showed this nung Wednesday that October worldwide is 39,966. Sa Philippines, 2,191. Starting March, bumaba ang ibinibigay na visa sa U.S. Embassy sa Philippines. It went down to 822. And as of August, wala pa yung September statistics. As of August, only 168 immigrant visas were issued at the U.S. Embassy here in the Philippines. So what will the petitioners and sponsors need to provide when the proposed rule becomes final in its current form? Bakit ko sinabing in its current form? Because there is a public comment until 2nd of November. Kung maraming nag-submit ng comments against this, against the proposed rule, if there are as many people who are against this, then they will revise the rule instead of having you, the petitioner, submitting 3 years, maybe yung current year lamang. So we don't know. But if you do not submit your comment until the 2nd of November, then the rule becomes final. So if the rule becomes final in its current form, ano ang magiging obligation ng mga sponsors and petitioners? First, you, the sponsor and household members or household members who submit an affidavit of support through must provide the federal income tax returns for 3 years. Because today, dun sa current rule, you're only required to submit your tax return for the current year, so yung 2019. If you're submitting the affidavit of support for 2020, you're only required to submit the affidavit of support, the tax return mo for the last year, 2019. Under this proposed rule, when it becomes final, you would have to submit your three years of tax returns, 3 years of your credit report, credit scores, and bank account information. So yun yung kaibahan, and that's the requirement na nadagdag. If you are the sponsor and if this rule becomes finalized on or after 2nd of November. Second, the applicant must submit an affidavit of support by a joint sponsor if the petitioning sponsor, sino yung petitioning sponsor? Ito yung nag-petition. So, for example, sa F1, sino nag-petition? Yung US citizen na parent. If the US citizen parent received any benefit, any means-tested public benefit on or after the effective date of this rule, let's say after next year, naging effective na tong rule, then if the petitioner sponsor or petitioning sponsor, if the petitioning sponsor is the parent in an F1 category, received benefits, then kailangan kumuha siya ng joint sponsor, executed ng joint sponsor. Yun yung second rule. Meron pang third rule. The third rule would require that, kasi ganito yan eh, if the petitioner sponsor does not have the sufficient income for the affidavit of support, because there's a federal poverty guideline for each year. For 2020, merong federal poverty guidelines. So if the petitioner cannot meet the income requirement for the number of households in the household where the petitioner is living, the household member would be limited. How many members? The Department of Homeland Security would like to authorize only the sponsor's spouse or an intending immigrant living in the same principal residence as the petitioner. So ito yung pagbabago. Kaya malilimit ngayon yung pwede mag-submit ng IH-64A na household member. So yun po yung kaiba nito. That's what could happen, and that's why we will tell you what you need to do just in case this proposed rule becomes final. When does the petitioner submit an affidavit of support? Ito po'y galing sa website ng State Department. There are several steps. So, step one, step one, you submit the visa application form. Step two, you pay the fees, then you complete the application form, then you upload the documents. When you complete the DS-6260 immigrant visa application form, the sixth step is when you submit your documents to NVC. Ito yung step six. This is when you submit your affidavit of support, and this is during the visa processing. So dun sa when the petition is filed, the petitioner is not covered by the public charge rule. Neither is the applicant covered by the public charge rule, because when a petitioner submits the petition to the USCIS, the only issues that are relevant would be, one, is the petitioner eligible to file the petition? Is it by US citizen? Is it by green card holder? Second, meron ba silang relationship? Sinong pinipetition niya? Because a US citizen can only sponsor yung over 21, yung children niya na married, yung kanyang parent pwedeng sponsor ng US citizen. Yung green card holder ay limited ang pwede niya ma-sponsor, only the spouse and minor children under the F2A category, or over 21 unmarried, hindi kasal. Over 21 unmarried of green card holders. Yun lamang ang pwedeng i-file na petition ng green card holder. So, when the petition is filed, the USCIS only determines whether the petitioner is eligible to file the sponsorship and whether there is established relationship. So the category will determine what the relationship, or the relationship will establish what the category would be. So, hindi issue yung public charge when the petition is filed. Hindi rin ito issue, the public charge is not yet an issue when the petitioner and the applicant submit the affidavit of support during the NVC processing. It's not an issue. Hindi pa yun ang issue. The only issue is, should you submit your affidavit of support? Yes, because it is a requirement. So, kailangan kayo mag-submit ng affidavit of support. The NVC staff does not even determine whether tama ba yung inilagay nyo. Na-meet ba nung petitioner yung poverty guidelines? No. The NVC staff only looks at whether you submit the document or not. So, ano yan? Yung tax return, yung W-2, yung withholding. There are essential requirements that you can submit sa NVC. The other requirements would be given to you by the consul during the interview. So, ang pwede nyo kumpletohin lamang yung essential requirements during the NVC processing para mabilis kayong makapag-process. So, again, hindi ito issue, yung public charge is not an issue when you submit your document, your affidavit of support sa NVC. When is the visa applicant considered to be a person likely to become a public charge at any time? During the immigrant visa interview. Because during that interview, then the consular officer, will verify the information on the affidavit of support. The staff at NVC, they're not authorized to verify kung ito ba'y totoong tao, talaga bang, the only thing that they would require from me is to submit evidence that the person submitting the affidavit of support is either a U.S. citizen, so U.S. citizen, U.S. passport, naturalization certificate, yun yung kanyang evidence sa U.S. citizen. Yung isa naman, kung green card holder, yung sponsor, then yung copy ng kanyang green card, yung front and back of the green card. Yun yung evidence, hindi pwedeng i-determine ng NVC kung ito ba'y totoo. When you submit the document, they believe that you submit a genuine document. Now, it is up to the consul during the interview to verify whether that green card holder or the U.S. citizen is number one, still alive, second, still in the U.S., and third, mula ba nung isinamit yung affidavit of support hanggang sa interview, eh may trabaho pa siya. Meron pa rin ba siyang income? So, the evidence will be verified by the consul during the interview, not during the visa processing stage. Kaya, yun ang dapat yung malaman. Alright. The consular officer will then check your affidavit of support and verify whether the petitioner is still alive, still domiciled in the U.S., kasi yung mga green card holder, pwedeng na-abandon nila yung residency. If, for example, from the time na ifinal yung petition sa inyo, nagbalik dito yung green card holder, wala siyang re-entry permit, nagstay sa Philippines ng more than 1 year, so wala na siyang status. Hindi na siya makakabalik sa Amerika. If the green card holder remain in the Philippines outside the U.S. for more than a year without a re-entry permit, then you will not be eligible for the visa. So yun ang bine-verify ng consul during the interview. Is the petitioner still eligible to continue with the petition and is there a established relationship? Yan. Yun po yung malinaw dyan. Now, ano naman yung public charge issue? Ito yung nagiging basis ng refusal. Inuulit ko lang, number one, it is not during the petition, yung number one. Ito, follow the arrow. Ayan, number one. The public charge issue is not the basis, not determined in number one when you file a petition. In number two, when you process with NVC. It only becomes an issue during the third stage, during the consular interview, because then the consular officers consider not just your affidavit of support, but your age, your health, your family status, your assets, resources, and financial status, including education and skills. Yun po yung tinitingnan ng consul during the interview, not during the NVC processing, and specifically, not when the petition is filed. Yun po yung dapat nyong malaman. So what are the factors that the immigration or visa officer must consider? We mentioned this earlier last Wednesday. Your age, because the younger you are, the better your chance of being given a visa. Remember, the main applicant muna, the principal applicant muna ang titingnan, because the derivative beneficiaries would only get their visa based on the approval of the application of the main applicant. So yung age ng main applicant, yung health ng main applicant, ano yung age, anong basis, yung kanyang birth certificate na inisyu ng PSA, yung kanyang health, anong basis, yung medical exam na kinuha niya sa St. Luke's, yung family status, siya ba'y tulad niyan, yung nasa photo natin dito, how many members in the family, siya ba'y married, siya ba'y single, divorced, widowed, ano yung assets and resources na available sa kanya, ano yung kanyang tinapos, meron ba siyang degree, meron ba siyang, nag-employed ba siya, para malaman ng consul kung siya ay pwede maging employed kung siya nasa Amerika na. And last, yung Form 64. So as you can see, the affidavit of support is only one of several factors that the consul will consider whether you will be a person likely to become a public charge at any time. Yun po ang dapat niyong malinawan. Ano yung likely at any time to become a public charge? Ito po yung nasa rule. At inilagay natin dito. That means you are more likely than not at any time in the future to become a public charge. In other words, you are more likely than at any time in the future to receive one or more of designated benefits. So pwede kayong kumuha ng welfare, pwede kayong so kung wala kayong trabaho, baka pwede kayong kumuha ng unemployment, kung kayo ay walang insurance, pwede kayong kumuha ng medical insurance, hindi kayo eligible doon. So if you get any of those benefits within a 36-month period from the date you were admitted into the US, if you receive benefits more than let's say twice or in 1 month, then it would be considered 2 months. But anyway, if during the 36-month period, ano nakalagay dyan, yung orange. If during the 36-month period, tumanggap ka ng benefit, then you will be considered likely to become a public charge. Ano yung positive factors? We mentioned this last Wednesday. What are the positive factors that weigh in your favor so that you will not be considered a public charge? One, you and the petitioner has household income, assets, resources, and support from the sponsor at least 250% of the federal poverty guidelines. Ano yung minimum? 125% of the federal poverty guidelines. If your sponsor has more than 125%, specifically 250%, then sigurado o maganda yung chance na mabibigyan kayo ng visa based on your resources. Second, are you employable? Pagdating mo ba sa Amerika ay pwede kang makapagtrabaho? Or if you're in the US, are you currently legally employed? Because remember, the public charge is not only for those who are applying for visas here in the Philippines, they're also applicable to those who are in the US. So if you're an adjustment of status applicant and you're in the US, you are authorized to work because meron kang nakasaminda adjustment of status while your interview is not yet there, you'll be allowed to work. So you're allowed to work and yet you cannot find a job. You're not able to provide them with evidence you're employed. Then you will be considered a public charge even though you have an approved petition. Yun ang ibig nating sabihin dito. And then third, if you have a private health insurance, kung nandito ka sa Philippines, then you must have your medical exam from St. Luke's. So, kung doon ay wala kang condition, you're healthy, wala kang COVID-19, or sabi natin COVID-20 or COVID-21, kasi hindi na siya 19 eh. Although, nag-originate siya ng 2019, baka COVID-20 na siya or COVID-21. So, if you're an immigrant visa applicant, andito ka sa Pilipinas, you pass the medical exam, then that's okay. If you're in the US, meron silang panel of doctors or physicians where you should have your medical examination done. So if you pass those, then those are positive factors in your favor. So you will not be considered a public charge at any time, to be a public charge at any time. Ano naman ang negative factors? Yung nabanggit natin kanina, you can work legally, but you are unemployed. Wala kang maipakitang trabaho. Wala kang prospects ng employment if you're here in the Philippines. So your record of employment in the Philippines will be looked at by the consul. Your age, your ability, your skills, your criteria, your education, communication skills, your English proficiency, titingnan nyo ng consul para makita kung ikaw ba'y employable pagdating mo sa Amerika. That's one of the factors. Then, second, you are uninsured. Ito yung negative factor. Ang medical exam mo, sinabi ng St. Luke's na you must go into medical treatment. And this medical treatment would be so expensive that it could require getting funds from the US. So, parang welfare ka doon. So, wala kang healthcare insurance, eh meron kang medical condition, then you can be denied the visa. This will be a negative factor when you apply for your visa. And if you've been in the US, nagpunta ka doon, meron kang tourist visa, nagpunta ka ng US, ikaw ay nahuli, nag-TNT ka, nahuli ka ng immigration. At nung ikaw ay dinala sa immigration court, ang sabi ng immigration judge, well, this person came into the United States, siya ay TNT na ngayon at wala siyang trabaho. So ang naging basis ng deportation sa iyo, pinauwi ka ng Pilipinas, ay public charge under 212A4. So kung ikaw ay nagkaroon ng ganyan charge, then hindi ka rin bibigyan. That's a negative, very negative factor para bigyan ka ng visa. So kung ikaw ay nag-TNT sa Amerika, that's a negative factor because you violated an immigration law. Ano yung mga basis ng refusal? We also described this last Wednesday. If the consul considers your visa application, they look at the affidavit of support, they look at your birth certificate, they look at your marriage certificate, they look at your DS-260 immigrant visa application form, they check your health, etc. But they believe that you need more documentation. So you have a documentation problem. Then it will be 221G. Ito yung temporary denial for incomplete documentation or lack of supporting documents. Then you, the applicant, will be given 1 year to comply and submit the documentation or explain the reason why you should be given the visa. And you only have 1 year to submit it. If you do not submit the required documents within 1 year, your visa will be refused if you don't submit it within 1 year. The other one is under 212A4. Ang ibig sabihin to, it's not just documentation. You have the documents, but the consul is not convinced that you will be able to overcome the finding of being a public charge. So, hindi sila convinced na you will be able to submit any documents immediately. So, ang mangyayari dyan, meron kang refusal, pero unlike the 221G, because the 221G, you have 1 year to comply. The 212A4, you have more than a year. Hindi ka limited sa 1 year. So let's say after 1 year, yung sponsor mo ay medyo tumaas na yung income, maganda yung kanyang kalagayan sa buhay sa Amerika, then pwede siya mag-submit ngayon ng panibagong affidavit of support, meron ka panibagong joint sponsor, hindi naman tumanggap ng public benefits ang iyong petitioner, so pwede ka mag-submit ulit even after 1 year. That's the difference between the two. Yung 221G, you have 1 year to comply. Yung 212A4, you have more than a year to submit documentation to overcome the basis for inadmissibility. Okay? Kung meron po kayong katanungan, hindi ko nabanggit kanina, if you have any questions, you need information, you need assistance with your affidavit of support, completion with NVC based on what we have discussed, you can give us a call at our telephone number. It's 63-917-526-8472. Or the other number is 63, if you're calling from outside the Philippines, would be 63-917-531-8472. If you're calling from the Philippines, then you all need to dial the 0917. So if you're in the Philippines, anywhere in the Philippines, then you dial our 0917 numbers. Yun, sumang-ayon po yung aming mga aso. Sabi nila, tama ang sinasabi ng aking boss. So why would your visa be canceled? Sinabi natin dito kanina. If your visa was refused under 221G, hindi ninyo na-submit within 1 year, then your visa could be canceled. Your visa application be canceled. If your visa issued 212A4, hindi kayo bibigyan ng more than a year, but your application remains pending. Okay. Pero yun ay isa lamang sa mga magiging circumstances. Ano pong pwede mangyari? Number one, if you have a child who is turning 21, inabot siya ng 21, then hindi na siya magiging eligible unless that child becomes admissible under Child Status Protection Act. Second, kung yung petitioner ay umuwi na ng Pilipinas, wala siyang available na income, so hindi kayo makakapag-submit. So, in that case, pwede kayong ma-deny ng inyong visa even under 212A4 because yung inyong kaso ay titingnan ng consul ngayon if you're not able to submit the documentation at yung petitioner ay nandito sa Pilipinas, when you submit your documentation later, mahirapan na kayo. Bakit? Kasi yung petitioner hindi na eligible. So, tingnan po ninyo kung ano yung magiging base ng refusal if you are refused. Hopefully, hindi kayo mare-refuse because you are able to comply, you were able to complete the documentation sa NVC, sa affidavit of support, and you were able to see kung kayo ay pwedeng mabigyan ng visa or ma-deny based on any of the factors that the consular officer would have to consider. Now, what can you do? Saan? Para saan? Dun sa proposed rule. You can do something so that the proposed rule may not be implemented in its current form. So what can you do? If you're the petitioner or sponsor, kung kayo ang petitioner or sponsor, you can submit your comments on the proposed rule. Andyan po, nakalagay yung website, yung link. Ayan. So you can see it here. Oh, sumagot naman yung manok. Tama daw yung sinabi ko. Ayan, oh. Ito po. Ito po yung link. Okay? Yan ang link. So, when we're done with the live report, you can go sa ating presentation and you can check out this link. And then if you're the sponsor, you can submit your comments stating your opposition to the proposed rule. Number two, you can get your tax returns and credit reports and other tax-related information ready just in case it becomes finalized. Whether it's the final rule in its current form or nagbago siya, kung kailanganin na mag-submit kayo ng tax returns and credit reports, nakahanda na kayo. So, kunin nyo na ito ngayon pa lang. Whether you are required to submit it or not, it's still good to have your credit score. And number three, if you're the petitioner, review if you have submitted an affidavit of support before. If you have submitted an affidavit of support as a joint sponsor, then you're still liable for that immigrant. So, you still must comply with your obligation with that immigrant kung ngayon ikaw na yung petitioner sponsor, but before, you were just the joint sponsor. Ganun pa rin. You're still subject to the public charge rule under the proposed rule. If you're the visa applicant, you should continue your documentation processing with NBC because the processing does not stop. Hindi ito humihinto. Tuloy-tuloy lang. You can continue processing your visa application sa NBC so that you can be considered documentarily qualified. So when the embassy reopens, you're there. Available na kayo. Eligible na kayo kaagad. Number two, review your employment records, academic qualification, if you can take up some courses ngayon para maging employable kayo later on, makakatuloy na sa inyo. If you cannot communicate effectively, then you may want to take up some lessons, some language proficiency exams and lessons para if you're in the interview, makikita ng consul, uy, nakakaintindi ng English to. So, pwede kayong, that will be a factor for you. Number three, explore the need to have a medical exam ngayon pa lang, bago pa kayo magkaroon ng interview date because St. Luke's will only give you a medical exam if you have an interview date. So in the meantime, kung meron kayong parang kinakabahan kayo, baka ubo ako ng ubo before, baka meron akong TB, baka meron akong COVID, etc. So pwede na kayong magpa-medical exam ngayon para kung sakali man na kailangan nyo ng treatment ngayon pa lang, then nakahanda na kayo. Alam nyo na kung anong dapat yung iwasan when you get your medical exam sa St. Luke's before the interview date comes. So maghanda na kayo ngayon pa lang. And then fourth, if you have previous visa applications na deny kayo, anong reason kayo na deny? Normally, the consul gives you a blue or green paper, depende kung anong available na color paper meron sa embassy at the time. It can be either blue or green. Is it 221G? Is it 214B? Etc. So, tingnan ninyo kung anong refusal. If you were refused before, makaka-apekto ito, especially kung kayo ay na-charge ng misrepresentation, nagsabi kayo ng fake documents. Nako, mahirap yan. So, these are the things that you can do while the USCIS and the DHS is considering the comments of the public because the proposed rule is subject to public comments until the 2nd of November. So, make use of this time. If you're the petitioner, then do what we have. Then you have the option of doing 1, 2, 3. If you're the visa applicant, then you have the option of doing 1, 2, 3, 4. Yun po ang inyong pwedeng gawin. Okay, ulitin po natin. Sa ating mga kaibigan, if you have any questions, you can text or call us at 63917-526-8472 or 63917-531-8472. And thank you. Marami pong salamat at yung aming pong mga dogs and chickens and roosters ay nagpapasalamat din at kay sumama sa amin ngayong Friday. So until then, have a safe and good weekend, mga kababayan. Ang atin pong laging sinasabi, if you have to leave, if you have to leave your house, huwag kayo maging pasaway. Magmaskara kayo. Okay? Hasta la visa, mga kabisa.